Monsieur, Mademoiselle, it is with deepest pride and greatest pleasure that we welcome you tonight. And now we invite you to relax, get yourself a snack, as Beyond the Trailer proudly presents your spoiler review. You're welcome, Ewan McGregor. I just made your accent look a little bit better. But I love Beauty and the Beast. And if you love Beauty and the Beast, I think you're going to love Disney's live-action adaptation, where there is so much to talk about. My notes? Wow! But this doesn't even cover it. In fact, for this whole week, I have videos planned about the film, all brimming with spoilers. We're gonna have so much fun. And I think it's interesting that a number of people lately have been saying, you know what, Disney, you should make a Disney princess cinematic universe. And maybe, just maybe, this is the first step, as suddenly a Disney princess movie is generating comic book movie level chatter. Now, my other videos are going to focus on the music specifically of the film and also the characters. So here, I want to talk about the film itself, and I want to start out with its most controversial talking points. All right, so number one, of course, is poor old LGBT LeFou, Bill Condon. So well-intentioned, so misguided. The two moments, all right, here they are. The two, you know, exclusively, he said there was just one. I think there's two moments in the movie. Our first, you know, it happened in the animated movie. The wardrobe, garderobe here, dresses one of the villagers in drag, right? It's just one in the animated movie, and, you know, he freaks out and runs away. But here, there's three guys, and two of them freak out, and one just has a total drag queen moment and absolutely loves it. It's the guy on the far left in the Gaston clip that we saw. And I think a number of us, you know, kind of, you know, were able, just as LeFou was kind of obvious, you know, you could also, you know, your gaydar would pick that guy up as well, let's say, right? And then later on, at the very end of the movie, LeFou is dancing with everybody. They're celebrating, you know, the beast is now human again, and so are all his servants. And they're changing up dance partners, as they so often do in that, you know, that era. But there's like an accident, and LeFou and this guy end up dancing together. And they just hold a moment where they're like, you know what? Maybe this feels right. Or like, I thought I was the only gay guy in town. And then they cut away really quickly. And both, I think, were played for laughs, like really played for laughs, like to the cheap seats. And they got laughs at the screening that I was at. And I have to say, the press screening that I attended had a number of people from the LGBT community in attendance, and nobody seemed offended. It's not quite the representation that Bill Condon promised when he was promoting it. And also, there were some odd moments, like when Gaston was like, oh, LeFou, why hasn't some woman snapped you up? And LeFou was like, it's because I'm told I'm clingy. And I was like, you do seem a little clingy. But I thought that was like, it was a cheap moment, and it threw away, I think, or undercut what Bill Condon claimed that he's trying to do here. So that was also kind of frustrating. I thought, you know, as I talked about in my non-spoiler review, LeFou kind of loses his footing in this, the latter part of the film anyway. But, you know, speaking of, you know, trying to do something nice for Howard Ashman, right, in the LGBT community, I would think that they would be like, you know, some kind of help is the kind of help that you don't want, right? I'm sure you've heard that saying. Because this was just, you know, instead of these being really wonderful, nuanced, or even just one really wonderful, nuanced LGBT character, it was just someone who was totally defined by their sexuality, particularly in those moments. I liked LeFou best during the Belle song when he had those fabulous one-liners like, ladies, it's never going to happen. But even then, they kind of turned him into like the stereotypical gay best friend. You know, he just happens to be for Gaston. Instead, usually it's for like a female character, like in Batman the Killing Joke, they gave one to Barbara Gordon. And that was like not cool. And so how can we say it's cool here just because Bill Condon, who's openly gay, dreamed it up? So I think that it does more harm than good for everything involved. I think it does more harm than good for the LGBT community. I think it does more harm than good for the movie. And I'm surprised that someone who is openly gay, and also, you know, maybe Luke Evans was like, I don't want to rock the boat. I'm just so happy to be in this movie. But that they would be at least Bill Condon would be so tone deaf as to what he was doing here. I'm just surprised. All right, so that's the first controversial talking point. Number two, Feminist Belle. Ooh, Emma Watson's really stepped in it a lot lately, particularly I felt with the Vanity Fair cover. You know, I've been supportive of her, but I felt that really was kind of hypocritical. We've talked about this, like, oh, if I walk around naked, it's my power. And it's like, not really, you know? And also, especially, everybody really got her when they were like, didn't you say something bad about Beyonce for the same thing a while back? I mean, that was bad. I can't believe, I mean, Emma Watson, you know, you can't go around critiquing other people and then do the same thing yourself and expect that not to come back and get you bad. But I can tell you that no matter what's going on with Emma Watson in her own life, it doesn't come into this movie. Belle is feminism 101. It's the introductory course. It's the kind of stuff that everyone can get behind. And even better, it's presented in a very soft and warm manner, right? You're like, oh, this feminism is a warm, cozy blanket. I love it. And then also the other thing that's great is that Belle, you know, she's not like a bunch of boxes that are checked, you know, and she's not abrasive, which is the way, you know, feminists are usually portrayed. And as many people claim Emma Watson is coming across these days. But here, Belle, she really seems like not only a wonderful person, but a very real person, flaws and all. She's not perfect, and that's, you know, made very clear. And I'm sure that our friends in the LGBT community are like, that's what I wanted with LeFou. It's what I was promised. But don't give up. We waited a long time for this version of feminism, so you'll get there eventually too. All right, so don't worry if you're like, I've heard a couple of people be like, I don't think I can sit through a feminist movie. And it's like, unless you're against women learning to read and going to school and being able to, you know, have some say in who they marry, you should be fine. And if you're not okay with those things, well, it's 2017. Come on, you gotta at least stick a baby toe in the waters of feminism. All right, so number three. What about bestiality? You know, everyone's like, well, people have a problem with a gay LeFou, but yet Emma Watson's Belle is falling in love with a man goat. I was worried about this too, to be honest with you. And I think that touche, that's another good point. You know, a lot of good points in the sparring over this movie on both sides. But I can tell you that in the end, it's not a problem for two reasons. One is that the CGI is medium on the beast. So you're never like, that is a man goat. You're like, that's Dan Stevens using a motion capture suit and they just lay it over that. I think you think that, but then I think a lot of times I'm like, you really can't do better than this? Like you see Kong Skull Island and you believe that there's an actual giant ape running around Skull Island. Yet I can't buy a beast in a tux. And I guess that's a harder sell if you put him in a tuxedo in a dining room. But it was hard. However, I also thought that Dan Stevens' performance was great. He also had a lot of warmth, and I thought that the conversations between him and Belle really did a lot not only to make the human side of him come through, but made their romance more believable. And that they weren't, you know, it wasn't like, I'd like to jump that man goat. It was more like, there's the soul in there and I'm connecting with it. That's the whole point of the story. So I liked the Romeo and Juliet conversation about, oh, you would like Romeo and Juliet and, you know, giving away his education and, you know, and, you know, showing that she was at a bit of a disadvantage. But, you know, I like that she owned up to it and challenged him. It was great. It was really nice. But then also the line where she admits that, you know, she wasn't very popular in town and, you know, he's unhappy that, you know, the servants, you know, he can tell that they don't like having him around and they don't have a good relationship. And then when he says, let's run away together. I was ready to run away. The way he said it and the way it was set up, I was like, oh, let's do it. You're so great. So that was great. That was wonderful. We'll talk more about where they ran away to a little bit later on in this spoiler review. But we're on controversial talking points. And number four is, the dress is so ugly. And it is ugly. It really is. The top of half of it in particular. I mean, it really looks like she's just wearing her undergarments, right? Like when she ends up in her undergarments, you're like, that looks a lot like your dress. Is that just another version of your dress? Did you buy it in different colors, Belle? But what saved it for me and made me kind of actually like the dress in some ways was the gold detailing. When the branches that decorated or adorned her room came to life and melted and then fell like snowflakes to create the floral pattern on her skirt. I was like, that is everything. I loved it. It was a great idea. It was wonderfully executed and it made at least the bottom half of the dress look really nice. And I liked the way it sparkled when it moved. I was mighty impressed. Although my favorite dress by far and away is the one that she wears at the end of the movie. And I was actually just at the Disney store recently, and they had the like the costume version of it, you know, for little girls. Wish they had it for adults. And I was like, oh, that looks really great. And I was like, man, why isn't this dress showcased more in the movie? I think any little girl who goes into the Disney store would be like, where's that dress from? I mean, unless you see it on the toy box, that's how little they show it in the movie. And it's just stunning. It's such a gorgeous dress. I guess Belle's not about the fashion and the clothes, so whatever. All right, so the fifth controversial talking point is it's an exact copy of the original animated movie. This is what I think the underlying anger over what happened with LeFou is what is responsible for a number of the bad reviews, but so was this. This was what people really complained a lot about, was that they felt it was too much like the original. But you know what? You got a feel for Disney, because you're damned if you do, you're damned if you don't. Like, imagine if they did considerably change it. People will be like, why would you change a masterpiece? The best, you know, the only Disney animated fairy tale to be nominated for Best Picture. Why would you change it? So they couldn't win either way. And so I thought what they did was that they matured it. They made it more sophisticated. It's a retelling for adults versus, I would say, and it becomes quite clear once you see this version, the shorthand version that's the original that you do for children's stories, right? It's like basically taking a children's story and it has all the same beats, but you write it with the detail and the emotions and the realism of a story for adults. And it really works. It's a great idea. And it's not an exact copy, okay? They do, as I said, mature it and add to it and enrich it. So let's discuss those changes, all right? So the thing I want to start with first is the little things that they changed. And they made a big difference. For instance, oh, I loved this guy. I talked about it in my, even in my non-spoiler review, but they added this minister who was where Belle got her books at the church instead of from a bookseller. Oh, I thought that was such a great idea for a number of reasons. Well, you know, one being that the actor they cast as the minister, he too had just such a wonderful warmth about him. It was just, I was like, you are an awesome guy. I would say he's the best minister I've seen in a movie, and a Disney movie, no less, both times, interestingly enough, since Carl Malden in Pollyanna. That's how much I like this guy. And he had far fewer scenes. But I like that, you know, she had the town didn't have a lot of resources, particularly for a woman or a girl, right? That she had to get her books from the church. She couldn't get them from the school because she wasn't allowed in there. And there really wasn't a place that sold books because nobody in town was interested in reading beyond, you know, school where they were forced to do so. So I think that underscored it. I also like that she had so few books to read. You know, it really wasn't like, oh, well, Belle just has no social life, so she just reads and reads and reads, and that's why she's read that entire bookstore. But here, it was really only just a handful of books on top of a table, so of course she has to keep rereading them again and again. And it really drove home just her love of reading, even under those circumstances. And then also why the library would mean so much later on when the Beast gifts it to her. You're like, yeah, she came from just like six books on top of a table. The other thing, though, is that it underscores the importance of the church, especially to outsiders. That is always a place where they, you know, if you feel left out. And I think, I wonder, I don't know, as someone who lives in the city, I don't quite know if the church still fulfills this. But, you know, they explore that in The Hunchback of Notre Dame. But the idea that the church is a place of sanctuary. And I thought that, you know, it's not as grandiose an example of that as The Hunchback of Notre Dame, but just the simple element, not only that she went and got her books from him, but when they mess up her washing machine, the people in the town, and the minister tries to help her, that was really wonderful. I just really, really liked it. So the other things that they had that were small, like they would take lines in the songs. Like I liked in Belle, when they took some songs and they actually made them, they turned them into criticisms of Belle, sung by the triplets. I thought that was really clever, and I thought a nice touch. And then also even in the dialogue, when the Beast explained, just, you know, offhandedly, but it made it work, where he was like, oh, I told her that the ballroom looked so nice after they cleaned it up and we should have a dance, and she said yes, and now here we are. I thought that was great. I was like, thanks for clearing that up. I wondered what made you guys decide to hold a fancy ball. I also like the West Wing jokes, right? I thought it was better than, I thought this was handled better than the animated movie. I thought that was fabulous when they're like, oh, this is this way to the East Wing. Oh, and as we like to say, the only wing. You know, I just thought that was great, the way Lumiere tried to cover for Cogsworth's mistake. I also thought the snowball gag was fantastic when, you know, Belle hits him with a snowball, the Beast, and then he hits her with a giant snowball that just totally knocks her over because he's a giant beast. It was great. It just made so much sense. It was fabulous. And I also even liked small, even smaller touches, like Belle reading at the dinner table. It's rude. You're not supposed to do it. But she, it's like everyone can relate to that. I used to read books in class, and I was so engrossed that I had no idea class had started up again. Class was beginning, and I was still at my desk reading my book from break. So I think everyone can understand, can relate to that, but also it shows how much she loves the gift of the library. So I thought that was great. Then another huge change is Kevin Kline's Maurice, who really is a superstar in this movie, both his performance and what they've done with the character. First off, he's utterly charming. He really helps sell this city folk who moved to the country narrative that they've put in here. It's great. It's really wonderful. It's like, and it's almost like, they don't really politicize it, but I think in some ways, and today, you know, today's so political, it's like if blue staters ended up having to go to a red state, right? I mean, I think that, but everybody, you know, no one's really too much in the wrong. You know, Kevin Kline, his character obviously makes some mistakes too. So I thought that was really nice. I thought that it added a depth to it. But I also like this idea of secretly why they left Paris. You know, they and that was great, that scene. You know, we all thought that was something to do with the Beast, but it was actually where Belle had been born. And I loved her parents were both artists, and it, you know, I think that was so clear in her personality and just her disposition and her parents' disposition. You know, so much of where you come from. You know, a lot of who you are is shaped by your experiences, but I think everyone can relate to the fact that genetics are awfully powerful from your parents. It's crazy, okay? So this really, I think, that grounded Belle. And maybe that's, now that I think about it, maybe that's why she was missing that piece of the puzzle of herself, where she came from. So this idea that her parents lived in this beautiful loft, and it was foreshadowed by that music box he was building, but in this small, tiny, but yet beautiful loft that they made with their craftsmanship and their love, but yet her mother had contracted the plague, and they had to leave. Kevin Kline's Maurice had to take Belle, and they had to leave her mother there to die alone. That's so sad. No wonder she wanted to go home. And they also did a nice job of keeping the rose motif with the rattle. But it was just great. And it worked so well into the narrative also that Maurice was just overprotective of Belle. And one of my favorite moments in the movie was when she's like, I have to go and help the Beast. You have to help me get out of this, you know, the wagon to go to the insane asylum. I like that they locked them in the wagon instead of back in their home. That was because it really, like, you're going to the insane asylum too, Belle. And you were like, oh my God. So Maurice is like, I don't know, it's dangerous. I think it's really a dangerous thing to do. And I love, with tears in her eyes, that Belle says, it is dangerous. Like, it is. Let's not fool ourselves, but that's something I need to do. What a moment. I can't wait to see it again. I'm so excited. I also love that Maurice was the one who picked the lock. And I like that he was like, oh, it's just like the moving parts of a music box. I can figure this out. And also how they did a callback to their relationship of her always knowing the right. I love, by the way, that she was an inventor instead of, I never liked in the animated thing that she was passive. Reading is somewhat of a passive thing to do, or it can become a passive thing to get to do. So I like that Belle was also someone who was an inventor and very proactive as well. So that was good. So anyway, I like that she helped them pick the lock instead of Chip saving them like the animated movie. I thought that was a much better change. And then also, what was really important is that Maurice wasn't crazy old Maurice. Because let's face it, in the animated movie, he was kind of crazy, right? You were like, I can see why everybody wants to maybe send him to the insane asylum, because he's had one too many cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs moments. But here, he's very, you know, there's an amazing clarity. And this, the way it played out, where Gaston says, let's go look for her. Like, you know, he doesn't throw him out of the tavern. I was like, what's happening here? So they go out, and then he admits, I just want to marry your daughter, right? And I like that they were having this, like, you know, there's so much at stake, and Maurice is so exasperated, and Gaston is so exasperated because this is, he's not getting Belle to say yes. They just have, like, a really honest conversation. And then it ends with Gaston saying, I'm just going to leave you for dead here in the woods, knocking him unconscious. I was like,
Oh my God. And so then Maurice, you know, because Agatha, we'll talk about Agatha, you know, but Agatha the Enchantress, who's disguised as this woman in town, the single woman in town, saves him. And then he's able to come back and accuse Gaston of attempted murder. And by the way, when LeFou backed up Gaston, I was like, I don't know if you can come back from that, LeFou. I think that was kind of like a line in the sand in terms of morality. But anyway, it really raised the stakes, and it made the whole situation so much more clear, so much more real. Not just, you know, so often in the movies, it's like ridiculous misunderstandings. Or, you know, here you were really like, I could see how this unfolded like this, and this is bad. Now, speaking of Gaston, he was a very realistic evil. It was shocking that to have this in a movie like this, and I was very impressed with it. And at times, again, it was not only, it was just shockingly realistic. You're like, this is an insidious evil because it just sneaks up on you, right? Not only because of the packaging, but just that Gaston takes his time. Oh, it was great. But the problem though is that it sacrifices the fun factor of the character, and not only in terms of the performance, but also the songs. I was so upset, as I said in my non-spoiler review, that they removed the line and every last inch of me's covered in hair. I was like, why even bother to sing the song? The song itself missed a lot of the fun. And Gaston, I have to say, actually was my biggest disappointment in the film. And I'm not saying, it's important to clarify, that Luke Evans did a bad job, but the character isn't as strong as he is in the animated film, nor as strong as he could have been here. He wasn't as bold and robust. He was maybe a little bit too au naturel. I think I liked what they added, but I didn't think they needed to lose the other things. They felt they needed to sacrifice it. I think they could have done everything and just amped up the character even more, is how I guess I would say it. Now, also, another change is the curse. Now, they do the prologue, but instead of stained glass windows, you see what happened. And I actually thought it was pretty mesmerizing. I know some of you are going to be upset to lose those windows, but I liked this quite a bit. I liked the idea that they hide the prince's face under all that makeup, showing that he's a different kind of beast, right? He has a different kind of, you know, distorted face. I thought that was a really, really clever choice. I also love this idea that the servants' loved ones had been made to forget them. Like, everyone thought the toy maker being like, I've forgotten something, was a reference to Harry Potter. And maybe it is. However, it was Mrs. Potts' husband, and the chip was his son. So that was actually quite tragic. And I would have liked more of those reunions, by the way, at the end of the movie. They were so rushed at the end that it came off a bit cliche and sometimes a little bit stale, right? You're like, come on, guys, you're better than this. Give me an extra 15 minutes in the movie. Although Agatha gets her own section. This is the Enchantress. And it's no accident that in a film, which is Feminism 101, the older woman who never got married is actually the town witch. You know, Gaston is like, you see what happens, Belle, to women whose fathers die and they aren't married? They turn into an old maid. And you're like, oh, you know. And so I thought that was really I liked it. It's bordering on being a little bit too much for some people, but I thought it worked. I have to say, you know, when she saved Maurice and was like, drink this, and, you know, clearly you're supposed to see that Maurice is a wonderful person, right? That he's like, I still love you, Agatha. I don't care if you live in the woods and a tree. You know, you're still, you know, you're bohemian. I remember this time in my life. But anyway, actually, come to think of it, they should have been friends. You know, it's like, ah, oh, let's get the ye old New York Times and discuss it. You're the only one who reads it, Agatha. But anyway, the makeup they gave her made her look to me like a leper. It really bothered me. I was like, I'm glad you want to be nice, Maurice, and I'm glad she did save your life. But I think she's a leper. You know, and also because she lived in the woods, I thought maybe she was a leper because oftentimes lepers would live in the woods because they weren't allowed in town. So I think they should have clarified that. She had leper makeup on, basically. But I thought the performance, though, by Hattie Morahan was fabulous. And she had no lines. But she still made a huge impact. And again, the curse, I liked that it was just more realistic. Now, instead of in the animated movie where the curse magically hears Belle whisper, I love you, even though it was too late, there's no do-overs. Here, it was too late. The beast died with his eyes open. Oh, that was bad. And the servants all made their final transformation into inanimate objects. Oh, that was really like, you were like, yeah, you went there. I love it. So, but Agatha heard Belle say, I love you. And, you know, she had gone in. You know, I liked when all the villagers were leaving, and Agatha's like, I want to see how my curse turned out. It seems things are happening here. I still feel maybe she put that lightning bolt and made the tree branch fall down, and she started the whole thing. She was like, this is taking too long. I can't live in the woods much longer. People think I'm a leper. But anyway, she had like this, she owned it. Agatha owned every scene she was in every moment. And so she was there to witness it, watching from, you know, being a peeping Tom, basically. Like, we have some privacy, Agatha. And then she was like, you know what? I know it's too late, but I'm going to reverse my curse. And she did. And I thought that was wonderful. And so finally, the magic. Oh, this really truly is a magical movie. Now, we've seen visual effects do a lot of things in the last couple of years. We know they can make Dan Stevens into a beast. We know they can build his castle. We know they can fill out the town. They can make silverware, sing and dance like they're in France. But I've never seen them do magic with VFX like they do here. There are so many moments where you were like, it's a freaking fairy tale book come to life. I can't believe it. Like, you know, at Disney World, they're like, do-do-do-do-do-do, and they have like some lights go off, and you're like, oh, I can imagine it. I'm going to squint my eyes and pretend it's real. You don't have to here. It looks real. So like in the beginning, when the Enchantress reveals herself to the prince and the glowing light and the way she was floating in the air, I was like, this is amazing. Also, the way the dress got the gold appliques on it, I was like, so much better than bedazzling. Also, the beast's transformation. Oh, with the rose petals around him from the flower that had, you know, all the petals had fallen off. I was like, yes, carry through the rose motif. I love it. But I have to say, and I liked when Dan Stevens stopped for a moment to look at his hands. It was exactly the exact same pose as the animated movie. I was like, wow, Dan Stevens, you nailed it. But he didn't look hot enough when he turned around. That was a real problem. And I'm really surprised that no one working on the set was like, he's not hot enough. Nobody. And he looks so hot on Legion these days. I know Dan Stevens can get there. All right, so, but here was, this really particularly made it bad. You want to know how bad it was? I don't know if any of you thought this was funny, but at the end of the movie, Emma Watson's Belle says, how would you feel about growing a beard to the prince when they're dancing on the dance floor? And he laughs. He goes, oh, you're so funny, Belle. But I bet inside that killed him. And at night, when they were asleep, he turned away from her and curled up under the sheets and cried himself to sleep, knowing that Belle thought he was sexier as a manimal than he was in his human form. That was so bad. But they could have made him look a lot better. That's the costume. That's the makeup and costume department's fault. That's totally, you know, their fault. So I thought that, I was like, wow, there's a stinger for you. Maybe sometimes it does step over the line with feminism, but Belle can't help the way she feels. She fell in love with him. I guess maybe they were trying to show that she really did fall in love with his soul, and that was the greatest time in their romance, so she wanted to have a callback to it. But I bet it really stung. So as I said in my non-spoiler review, I truly believe that this is the next step in the evolution of Disney fairy tales, from 2D to 3D animation to now live action. And I don't think there's any looking back. And also, I just honestly feel this movie is jaw-droppingly good. And it's been over a week since I've seen it, and I still think it's as good as The Sound of Music, My Fair Lady, and Mary Poppins. It's right up there in that group. And I think it deserves to be a major awards contender, including Best Picture and Best Actress. I was going to put director in there, but I think Bill Condon dropped the ball maybe one too many times for him actually to get nominated, but his movie would. And also, I think maybe even the screenplay, now that I think about it, because I think that they were able to really be faithful to the original, but do such a wonderful job fleshing it out. All right, so that's my spoiler review of Beauty and the Beast. I can't wait to discuss it with you down below. The gloves are off. Write whatever you want, because this is, again, the spoiler review. And stay tuned for my other videos this week about the music and the characters specifically in the film. Oh, so much to discuss. All right, and you can check out some other videos right now.